Welcome back to Bump Love. Being a parent has no manual. Can we say that together?
Being a parent has no manual.
The idea of having children seems pretty exciting on paper. This is before you realize that you're taking on, or you've taken on, a lifelong responsibility. A commitment to nurture and raise this human being until he's able to launch into society. Often, we usually fall back to what I personally call my parenting North Star. These are principles by which we are raising our children. These are systems that have been woven into the very fiber of our society. These are places, these are people that we seek knowledge from. Today, we'd like to talk about raising children, the ideas we had before we had the children, and what we are practicing currently.
I feel like I go first all the time, but let me. So, I was thinking about this question and I was like, to be honest, no, I didn't. I think I was one of those people who was just excited about the idea of having children. But somewhere in my deep subconscious, there were a couple of things that were running through. I guess based on how I was raised, there were things that were important to me. And I just want to point out two things. One was my faith. So I grew up in a very religious home. My dad is retired now, but was a pastor. And so for me, when I thought about having children, I envisioned them in Sunday school. I envisioned them serving somewhere in the church and, I guess, professing Christ. So that was definitely paramount. I didn't have a strategy, but I knew that when I have children, that is something that I want to be able to pass on to them. The second thing was to be able to model a good marriage, because, I mean, I had witnessed and had heard stories about, you know, I guess, and it's unfortunate when a marriage fails, but that somehow impacts a child depending on how the parents managed the separation. And so for me, it was important that my marriage was modeled very well for the children that I would have. I guess that the family unit for me made sense when both parents are together. Yeah, yes. So those were the two things.
I feel like you have...
What?
You know, because every time, okay, so when you're thinking about things before, in retrospect, everybody's saying, okay, get an education, get a job, get married, have children.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I've said this on this show before. I think I have. I never ever wanted to have children.
You have said it.
I think I have. So there's no way I could think about raising children who I knew I was not going to have. And honestly, it's just that because for me, my order got confused. I had that part of get married and have children never crossed my mind. Yeah. It was just career, get a job, get a progress in my career, advance my academics even further, advance my career even further. I never ever thought about anything else outside that. That's where my life was. Wow. That's where my life story. Whatever happened after that, who knows?
Who knows?
Problem came when the order... fell in love, got married, natural progression of things dictates. After marriage, you get kids. Then the child came. And to be honest with you, that's when I started winging it. Not a thought, a second before. So I'm here to learn.
Okay, so it's interesting you say that, Pumla. I think this is the very first time like we're going to really differ. I kind of feel like... So I've always told you guys that I was a child, and then immediately after I was done being a child, like age 13, I started to care for children. So very immediately, even if it, I guess, I don't want to say it was in my subconscious, but I just was really aware of children and of babies. And so I was constantly around children, and I was constantly saying, I don't want my child to be like that. I want my child to be like that. I don't want my child to be like that. Oh my God, I think she's such a nice mother. Oh, look at her. Very, very young. Before I was a mom, I would see this lady and I'm just like, I want to be like her. I even want to talk about her now, but I know I shouldn't say her name. But I look at her, I'm just like, look at her kids. Like, and then I would watch her every time she would come to Sunday school, because I was doing this while I was in Sunday school. So I would watch this mother. She's so composed, looking nice. Christ, model marriage, all of those things that we've talked about. So I feel like for me, I was very, like when it came to having my children, I knew what I wanted to do with them and what I didn't want. I knew what had been done with me, what I think could have been done better because I could see somebody else and how they'd raise their children. I was so lucky to have so many children at my disposal to see what they look like, what they come out like, how they express themselves. And so very early, I was just like, I can see what you're doing. I'm going to watch because that's exactly what I want to do. I see what you've done. I like that. I've seen what you've done. I don't like that. Yeah. I ain't going to do it like that. Yeah. So for me, I think that's how. Wow. Yeah.
For me, of course, I'd always wanted to have children. Mm-hmm. But to say that I knew what I would do raising them, no.
It's a lie.
It's a lie. Like, life happened after the baby had come and I'm like, all right, you know, life has started happening. You know, I actually feel like life for me really started happening after the children have come. Like, that's when you have a person to take care of, you know. But anyway, what I thought about mostly is because I knew I had a job to do and I knew I had to go back. So I thought about what I was going to do. That was after the child had come, how I would just organize myself and have someone to take care of my child while I was away. I also knew that I wanted to raise disciplined children. So at an early age, you would see me spanking them back in line. Because, like, I don't want you to be this, especially when visitors have come. You know that thing of, you'll start doing these things, disappoint me when these visitors are here and embarrass me. So get in line. Yeah, the truth is I tomelad because, you know, I had no money. I just had to put myself together after the children. But thinking about it before, I was like, yeah, let the child come. It would be nice to just see you carry your child. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
You don't remember how she was?
I don't remember.
Oh, you don't remember?
I don't remember life before having. I think I've been a mom longer than I've been anything else. So I don't remember.
So that means that there is. Okay, so in that breath now, that especially you, Angie, who doesn't remember, what then has influenced your mode of parenting?
My parents.
Okay.
My parents. I mean, I could speak of so many other things, situations, this, that, the other, but my parents, for sure. My mom.
So that's how your parents raised you is what the idea.
Yes, tough love. One second you're being chapwad peku heaven. Next second it's all love and sugars and my parents without a doubt. Without a doubt for me.
I think the same for me too. I think it's mostly my parents, my background, and not because entirely I believed entirely in how they raised us. I'm not sure. But because we all collectively turned out great, and to quote my mother, this is exactly who I wanted my children to be when they were older. You know this miyayu kebi in our family, we don't have miyayu even one.
Not even you, right?
So you see, I'm the miyayu, but I'm all right. So so for me it's mostly about I didn't know if I wanted that to do that. I felt it was so tough and so, you know. But then I feel like I have to incorporate it because we turned out all right. So there must be some truth in that raising.
Yes.
And then, of course, I got thrown to an end where they raised us as two parents. And now I'm finding myself in a place where I'm a single parent at a point and then a co-parenting after that. Mm. So for that point, it's been entirely YouTube has saved my life. Books.
Books,
research, speaking, actually psychologists have also saved my life because I find myself talking to people so much about parenting now, reading so much about parenting now, researching so much about specifically co-parenting. So my now I'm on a journey that's really being influenced by acquiring knowledge from so many other different sources and trying to combine that with the way my
I think the both of you, my parents have influenced me a lot. My parents and my grandparents.
Oh,
Oh. Yeah, my grandmother in particular, she has raised 14 children, well-rounded, disciplined. So I look back and I'm like, because I remember when we used to visit in the village, the things she used to do, the empathy she had around the grandkids, like I look back, I'm like, yeah, I'll apply this for my kids as well. And also my mom, honestly, she didn't do a bad job. Yeah, we've also turned out all right, yeah? Sure. Yeah, so she modeled us right. Sure. Yeah, I look back and see that, I get most of the influence from her.
The foundation for me is my mom. But then also I look at where we're going in this world. And I know, and you guys have heard me say that before, we can't raise our children the way we were raised because we are raising them for a world that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
And so I'm aware that there's a certain world that I have no idea what it looks like, and I'll probably not even be a part of it, in the sense that I can still be there to effect certain changes in my children at that point. Yeah. So I kind of feel like that's now for me where I engage people like TV or YouTube or even cartoons, because
Tell me about Peppa Pig.
Peppa Pig.
Such a family-oriented one.
Especially the family-oriented cartoons, because you see the way, because I kind of feel like there's a certain world out there that has gone ahead of us. And so it's the nearest I have to ahead of what I don't know is going to happen. Yeah. So I just look at what they're doing and I say, okay, is that something I want to incorporate or is it not? And some of those things then I incorporate, some I don't. I really still try to keep everything that my parents taught me and how they raised me. My mom still really, really spunked us. So I really still do some really good. But I also still speak with my children. I still talk with my children. I also then relate with them differently because I now know they are different children. My parents didn't. They clobbered us all at once. They didn't care. Like, they were just did like, they? All of you did the same.
Most of us.
You all ate from the mango tree before it was ripe. Exactly. All of you get slapped. They didn't know that some of us it was better to talk to and some it was easier to just spam. So now just incorporating some of those things that I'm learning, and the truth is I can't have learned them from my mom. I have to learn them from research, cartoons,
YouTube, Google,
learning. So of course now for me, I study early childhood, so also that helps a lot. Yeah. A lot. So I guess for me that's how my parenting right now is being influenced.
Yeah, I just wanted to point out that, so I guess for all of us, that's what we know because we're raised from, different families. And I think also for me, the foundation that I got from my parents is what I'm using, or sort of picking the good stuff.
Yeah.
What is, not shocking, but what is the revelation for me in how we are raising our kids vis-a-vis how we were raised is, for example, I pointed out that modeling a good marriage is important. Okay. However, I do know that my parents had to, there were a lot of things that were happening in the background that I was not aware of. Sure. Yeah, so now having that knowledge for me is very important because they presented a united front all the time. Like growing up, I didn't think my parents fought. I thought, my parents, they have the best marriage in the world, For us, I guess they had to paint that picture. And I think that it was very important. So now, knowing, because I'm much older and I sometimes have conversations with my mom, and knowing that there were struggles that they both went through, trying to create, to have that environment, and I realize how difficult it is because I have struggles in my marriage as well. I remember one time we were having a conversation with Ben, I think we were resolving
an issue
and tensions were starting to rise. Micah was somewhere in the living room and he was watching, I'm sure, Peppa Pig. And so we started going at each other, thinking that he's not paying attention. Yeah. So he gets off his tab and he's like, "Daddy, don't talk to mommy." And so we caught ourselves. So in that moment, I was like, oh my God, I have failed, because my parents never did that in front of us. So I feel like, yes, we get ideas from how our parents were raised, but there's always a separation. Like for you now, there are things where you're like, I'm not too crazy about how I was raised in this regard, so I want to read and do better. For you, it is the single parenting. You have to sort of educate yourself. So just sort of this is how I was raised, and I'm picking the good stuff and then the not so good stuff you're
reading about. Yeah, I like that you point that out, like just picking the good stuff, because Bambi, the bad stuff was there, really. So you can't say you're being influenced by everything.
So then what are these guiding principles? Because most of us clearly say that we kind of use our parents and how we were raised, our background, as some kind of model, you know, for what we're doing. So what are these guiding principles that you're using, that you'd say you're using or you consider as you're raising your children?
Mine, I'll start with every child is different, because that is so at mine. They are all different. So I try to fit in everyone's, you know, kind of love language, their world. It's really difficult because for everything, they will not like the same thing. Even cartoon, they'll fight me, I like this, me, I like this. It involves money, you know those things. Now you have to buy another TV somewhere because they are fighting. If it's a tab, they can't share because, but that's one. Two, I listen to them. Try and help, try and listen, like really listen. It's been hard listening to three children, is no joke. For now. I actually really started also asking for attention. I used to say three, now four. So I'm really, really trying to listen to them. I have some that are really, like two are really, really hard, like they will pull for your attention, you know, they are really strong-willed. I also let them be, like I let them take their decisions sometimes, which helps them. So yeah, those are some of the things that I'm using. Those are some of the principles at mine.
Yeah. Pumla pointed out that we're using, you know, how we're raised as some sort of model. And one of the things that I really appreciate my parents, one, what I'm trying to incorporate as I'm raising Micah, is we were always celebrated growing up. So whether it was a birthday or you did well in class or, you know, you learnt a lesson. I remember when we were talking about the bedwetting episode, my mom reminded me after she watched the episode and said how I went to church and gave thanks that I had stopped bedwet.
So in testimony time.
Testimony, people. I survived bedwetting.
We thank the Lord.
Yeah, but like even before I gave the testimony, at home it was like... Yeah, I was celebrated, and I just wanted to point that out. There are many other things that, of course, the marriage thing, and now I'm being more conscious and deliberate about how I manage my struggles with my husband in front of Micah. Yeah. But yeah, the celebration for me was key to point out, because now we see Micah doing certain things and we are deliberate about celebrating him and praising him for achievements, however small.
Yeah. So I think for me, mine is actually based off a scripture in the Bible, Luke 1:24, and it was, you know, after Jesus had been born and the celebration and the wise men and the shepherds and what, then they kind of say, the Bible says, and you know, and he grew
in favor with God and in favor with man.
So for me, that's my guiding principle, and it's so funny because it's the same one that we use for the credo. In favor with God and in favor with man. So I'm very big on the fact that children are, I raise the kids not for myself but for the world.
For the world, yes.
That's the first thing I look at. So what are they going to give to this world? Am I preparing them? Am I equipping them for what they can give to this
to the world?
And then what can they give back to God? So I'm really looking at that. Like how are they glorifying God? How are they living? Like what kind of life are they living? Like are they gaining favor from God? And then in wisdom, like I'm very big on their brain and their knowledge and their understanding and their learning and, you know, all of those intellectual things. They need to be like Auntie Pumla. Like, you know what I mean? Like, do you click?
Amen, sister.
And then also just the usual development, the usual development. Like, are they growing? Like, for real, are they growing? Are their teeth okay? Is their body okay? Are they running? Are they healthy? Are they eating right? Are they, you know, so wisdom, stature, favor with God, favor with man. That's for me is a principle.
Nice.
Oh, what I was also going to say, the truth is, looks like everybody has said everything. But looking at them now that they're older, I think, yes, the things that I'm glad that I instilled, and hopefully they can carry on with them. I think they make life integrity.
Yeah.
Consistency.
Oh my gosh, consistency. Yes.
Because that one, integrity, consistency, and empathy.
Yeah. If, I was waiting for empathy.
Yeah. Yeah, for me. If you have these three, yeah. I do not, with everything else we've spoken about, I do not see how your child can fail to launch into the world. Yeah.
I totally entirely agree with you. And
I decided to raise my, when I eventually came to it, after when I was winging and realizing, Banange, this winging can be a bit. So when I eventually realized that Banange winging, it might not be, you know, and I came around to it, and I realized that, especially back from my parents thinking, that everything I do or choose not to do has an impact on my child later on.
Yes.
I may not see it today, but it has an impact later on. So every decision I make to do or not to do with or for my child, so that's for me what my North Star really is, that what have you done and what have you not done? What is the impact? What is the consequence eventually? Might or might not be, but is a clear consequence. So the cornerstone hinged on that for me, three as yours. I want to raise a loving, independent, disciplined child. I need an adult for me to just have love. So my cornerstones, my value guiding principles, love, independence, key independence. It might be in the middle, but it's even before love. Independence meaning self-reliance and disciplined.
Yeah.
True. Very true. Ladies, how do you measure or keep account of your parenting journey?
So I just before we even answer that question, I just want to point out how broad this subject is.
True.
Yes. Yeah. And that, you know, from like all of the stuff, if we were to ask Pumla to break down loving, independent and all of that, or for me, celebration or
2-week course,
right? You might have to pay for. So that. I just wanted to point out that it's such a broad subject on how we're raising, and I think that even when you have your true north, there are certain things that you learn with time. Like maybe next month there might be something like, I want my child to be able to do this again, based on a changing world. But for me, I guess how I keep accountable, so because I'm living with the father of my child, that is one an accountability point. So we have conversations a lot about how we are raising Micah. I remember last night we were chatting about how much sleep he's getting. I was reading an article, I guess preparing for this show, and they were saying how, you know, when a child gets less sleep, they are less focused, they are less creative, and all those nasty things. So I was just thinking about, hey, how much time does Micah spend sleeping? So we're having a conversation about, so we sort of keep each other in check, actually a lot. When he feels like I'm being hard on him, or when he feels like I'm being too soft, he will check me and I will check him. So for me, having that conversation is very important. And then of course with the other people that spend time with Micah, who is my parents, because he spends a lot of time there. So when my mom sees something, she'll have a conversation with me about it, good, bad or ugly, so that we are able to either fix or catch in time or celebrate.
Very true.
Yeah, mine is also the people that they spend time with. So I'll see a lot, like, say for example today the kids are here for the shoot. They are going to engage with you guys, and then you guys talk, like, you know, you say stuff, and good, bad, ugly, it's a good thing to know where you're at, or even just to watch your children interact with some other people, either adults or younger children. You're able to see, well, how well, you know, kind of like mark yourself, how well am I doing? I told them that this, I've not done so well. So you kind of self-check. So I use other moms, I do a self-check. And then, yeah, also my spouse does help a lot, because he'll give those random book comments, you know those ones where like, as if, so I like that. And then also sometimes strangers, I like Ubers, which is quite funny. I like Ubers, like when we take an Uber and I leave, I keep quiet and listen. and watch and hear what are the conversations they are saying. Yeah. What are they talking about? Yeah. Are they growing in wisdom? Yeah. Are they growing in stature? Are they growing in favor with God? Like I listen in and I say, okay, it looks like I'm not doing really well. Here I could do better. So I use that. Then I also use the school. I get feedback from like the school. Of course, now they are closed, but I do get feedback from the school. The other time, I'll never forget a time when they're in a Christian school. And so the headmistress was saying, you know, we did an interview of all the kids and we're asking them, what do you love about your mommy and what do you love about your daddy? So it was quite shocking that your two children kept talking about God. Like, how much time do you spend talking to them about God? And I'm just like, actually, not a lot, but it looks like they're catching something. Like they're catching, it's coming from somewhere, and I'm glad for that. So I also use the school. I use the school a lot. Yeah.
So I think accountability for me also, like the two of you, they are father. We are always, you know, checking, do this. If he feels I'm not doing, you know, I'm not pushing them hard, he'll tell me, no, I need you to enforce this. He needs to come out. So I use him for accountability most of the time. They are caretakers.
Yes.
Yeah, when they let me know how, because I normally have this, you know, evaluation of that day. Tell me, how did they spend? Did they do any bad things? Are they being nice to people? Yeah, so those two mostly are the ones that I always account myself with. But also, when I go into prayer, there's a way. Hey, there's a way God really tells you, but here you need to change. So accountability from God. That, like your mommy was saying the other day, Holy Spirit,
yes,
it will guide you. It will guide you. So it's so true. There are times when I'm like, yeah, actually, yeah, they are telling me to do this, and yeah, so accountability is from there as well.
In my case, I'll say, when they were younger, back to what I'm always saying is that I made it very easy for outsiders to tell me if something is wrong. Because as parents, the truth is, you can't see, but she's so young, or things like that. So I go out of my way to let the people around me, be it friends, be it whatever, that I would love if you told me, or I have no problem. If you give me the feedback, the way I take it will encourage you to give it to me another time. Yeah. But that is when they were younger. Yes. But now that they are older, and I'll say this, I even had to think about it, because I'll be honest when I say, I'd never really consciously decided that I should balance my books, you know. Yeah. All I did is I jumped in and I did what I could.
What you could, yeah.
But now that I'm older, I go back to what Rachel says.
Which is what?
Having older children.
Yeah.
When you can see, but you no longer have that much control.
Yes.
So the best thing you do, like in my case, now I check myself, and it's usually when I'm completely naked. And I don't just mean physically, but even inside. I open myself up and I say, Lord, whether it's God or yourself or that inner thing, and you're like, have I done what I needed to do?
I actually want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
Are your children who you wanted them to be?
Before COVID.
Oh.
Before COVID. Oh, so the answer is yes, before COVID.
Yes.
Oh, because COVID complicated.
And I'm not saying it's in a bad way.
Yeah.
But the truth is, those who have little children, I hear them saying, "Bananga bana badayo diku somero." Now imagine me with three men in the house. Who, yes, they'll do online for 5 hours.
Yeah.
And you called her boys men.
Men.
What's that?
Wow.
What? Sorry.
Men?
Yes.
Not her babies.
I think the context matter.
I think COVID has brought up men.
Yeah, and not the whole COVID. Like, you know, like this past like 1 month or so. Yeah. I get home like Friday, like about, you know, 6. I'm like, hey guys, what are we going to do? I'm thinking we're high. They're like, you know what, mom, we out. So Friday evening, I'm at home
by yourself.
And I'm like, Lord, that's why I said men, because nowadays they will. Yeah, but children are not supposed to be home for this long. Yes. So when I say that, it's because at the moment, children are like, you know, sheep that are just going like this. Yes. Where the wind blows, they go. Where the wind blows, go. The only difference is when the wind is blowing a child in P2, it's different from the wind blowing a person who's supposed to be at university. They're thinking, what next?
Yeah.
So, yeah, at the moment, but if the world could open up, the second they start buying me first class tickets.
They are good.
They will have arrived.
Yes. So strangely, actually, Angie, I really, really wanted to hear from you, because I decided a long time ago that I will only check my child when he's out of my guidance and control.
Yeah.
I have no, I don't balance.
Yeah.
I don't balance my books.
Now.
Yeah. I don't.
Yeah.
Because I, and this is back to my upbringing as well. If my mother, if I was my child, if I was my mom's only child, and my mother balanced her books, my mother would have been a failure every day. Because of the type of child I was. And you know, it's when, that's why I said at the beginning of the show, when my mom told me later that, Pumla, you are exactly who I wanted you to be.
Wow.
That's
the only time I think my mother said, yeah, as in that, this is what I was shaping you for, but the struggle that I went through to get you there. If I was being evaluated, I was the one not in class. I don't want to do anything. I was rebellious. I was the one suspended. I was the one expelled. I was the one who had to commute for exams. I was the one, I was doing everything wrong. I was the rebel. I was the one, I was the only one in my family who went for coaching. And when they went to check on me in coaching, I wasn't there. I had gone to the cinema to watch other things. So when I analyze myself, and then I look at my child and I see a lot, I see a lot of his dad in him, so there's that self-control. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I see that fire, that my fire that I had. So, and I see it come out sometimes, and I don't want to because I know what it did to me.
Yeah.
So I decided, you know what, I wake up every day knowing that as Pumla, I'm going to do the best I can do for my child.
Yeah.
I'm going to do it. So why am I, what am I checking? I agree for corrective, I have corrective mechanisms because I accept feedback. If there is feedback, if somebody comes and says, oh, there's something, or if I see something, or if I witness or made aware of something, I'll correct, I'll try to fine tune.
Yeah.
But that is also part of my doing the best that I can do.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I don't balance any books. I decided when my child is out of my guidance, out of my control, then I'll sit back and watch.
I think
that's for me. It's a decision I made.
Yeah. I kind of feel like that's where we'll all end up anyway.
That's
we might be calling it checks and balances, and yet it's just us trying to make
fine tune as we go along the way.
It might not be checks and balances for all of us. Because that's why I asked her that question. I'm just like, do you sit back and say?
Because I really wanted to hear what Angie was going to say. Because that's the age that's when I will decide that.
Now, if there was no COVID, I would be able to answer that question. But right now, I think what Manuela has said is completely explained. The truth is, you take accountability of what?
But also because you have a small window to instill certain things.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
In your child, which is why Angie's at this point thinking and checking,
so
her question is in retrospect, it's not what can I do, what can I find you now?
True, because at this moment,
at this point, they're grown.
You just hope that everything that you did will finally pay off.
Yeah.
Ladies out there, do share with us your experiences, drop us a comment, don't forget to like our pages and all our socials. And do remember that the Kampala Serena Hotel hosts brunch every Sunday starting from 12 p.m. 110,000 shillings for adults and 65,000 shillings for children between 5 and 12. Come enjoy mouth-watering cuisine with your family and loved ones. With love from Bump Loves.